Welcome to Get Rich Education. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. Inflation and taxes are two insidious thieves that are out to steal your wealth. Learn inflation and tax lessons from me and just what you can do to check their erosion on your wealth. Later, Tom Wheelwright joins me yet again on new actionable angles to permanently reduce your tax burden today on Get Rich Education. Congress just made it possible to get up to $100,000 out of your current 401k or TSP to invest in real estate, gold, or even your own business. That's even if you're still working, and avoid the IRA UBIT tax. The thing is, you can get your money tax and penalty free for a limited time. The EQRP is your secret weapon. With the CARES Act expiring soon, the EQRP company helps you unleash your retirement funds now. Learn more and text message EQRP in all capital letters to 72,000.
You're listening to the show that has created more financial freedom than nearly any show in the world. This is Get Rich Education.
Hey, you're inside GRE from Teaneck, New Jersey to Turlock, California, and across 188 nations worldwide. I'm Keith Weinhold. This is Get Rich Education. As we're talking about inflation and taxes today, understand that taxes are the overt thief of your wealth, and inflation is the stealthy thief of your wealth. That's because all of your life, you've seen various tax bills in various forms, but you've never seen an inflation bill, because a tangible inflation bill does not exist. But there are all kinds of bills that you've seen for taxes on your paycheck stub, on your property tax statement, and even on your Home Depot receipt if your area has a sales tax. Inflation, that diminished purchasing power of your dollar, that is just one of many reasons why savers lose wealth, stock investors maintain wealth, and that real estate investors build real wealth. Look, right now, I am refinancing multiple rental properties since mortgage interest rates hit historic lows yet again, and you can get a 30-year rate on a primary residence at under 3% right now, and it looks like on my rental properties, which are the ones I'm refinancing, I'm going to get 3.5% interest rates on all of them. Look, just understand the amazing opportunity that this is. I don't know if you've ever thought about it this way before. If you get a 3.5% loan on investment property, well, that may very well be just below 3% with your tax benefits rolled in. Well, then this is about the same as long-term inflation in the United States. So therefore, if you get a 3.5% interest rate on your real estate, even if you get zero cash flow from that rental and zero appreciation from that rental for all 30 years, you still wouldn't lose any money. You wouldn't lose any money even in that implausible scenario of zero appreciation and zero cash flow. Gosh, that is just remarkable. Now, another thing that occurs when you get that loan, inflation really debases your debt in a couple ways. If you think about it, let's say your rental property has a $100,000 mortgage and then a $500 monthly P&I payment, just to use round numbers. I've talked before about how a 3% inflation rate means that your $100K in total mortgage debt is debased over time, but so is your $500 principal and interest payment, because after 1 year, then you would only pay back $485 per month. And the next year, $470 per month. And the next year, $455 per month in inflation-adjusted terms, if inflation were 3%. Yeah, so inflation debases your debt in two different ways. And keep in mind, this year at their policy symposium, which is hosted by the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City, the Fed left the door open to target higher inflation in the future. And you've got to keep in mind that inflation debases your equity and your debt at the same rate. Yeah, it erodes your equity value. Well, that's a bad thing. So that's why it's helpful for you to own many properties with low equity positions Inflation also debases your debt, like I just described. Well, that is a good thing, so it's helpful for you to own debt tied to cash flowing assets. And you know, despite all that, with interest rates at or below the long-term rate of inflation, some people would still rather accelerate their mortgage payoff by paying extra principal rather than borrow for more real estate. And that, in almost every case, is not a good idea. Keep your good debt. Now, the renowned economist John Maynard Keynes, not that I agree with all of his theories, but he suggested that a small amount of inflation is actually the sign of a thriving economy. I think that largely makes sense. It shows then that there is sufficient demand in a market, and that means that consumers like you would have the capacity to pay ever higher prices for everything from a box of chocolates to a box of Wheaties to a fourplex building. Now, with changes to our political leaders, some people are expecting taxes to go higher. Understand, though, that higher taxes reduce inflation. And if you don't understand that, it works a lot like bids at an auction house. Now, just imagine that a group of bidders, they want to enter this auction house to bid on art items, call it Sotheby's. But before those bidders can enter that auction house with their pockets full of money, let's say that at the door, 40% of their money is removed. It's pulled out of those bidders' pockets before they're let inside the auction house to bid on the art. Well, now there might be just as much demand for those pieces of art, but they're going to sell for lower prices precisely because you took 40% of the money out of bidders' pockets. They've lost an ability to bid up prices. Well, I made that analogy because it works the same with consumers in an economy. If you tax them more, then you, the consumer, you're going to have less money to bid up everything from a pound of dried mangoes all the way up to a single family home. This is exactly why higher taxes lead to lower inflation. So less spending by consumers, and then that corresponding reduced demand ultimately drives manufacturers and retailers to have to lower their prices, just like it would with art at Sotheby's Auction House. Now, lower prices, that's not necessarily a good thing for the economy. A big reduction in disposable income and inflation, that often has a negative impact on businesses that can ultimately hurt the economy. Now, when we talk about the two wealth destroyers here, taxes and inflation, one reason that you have to handily beat inflation when you invest, you need to fantastically beat it, and you can do that with something that pays you five ways, like real estate. One reason that you really have to handily beat inflation is the fact that the IRS does not even recognize inflation in a way. If you buy a stock for $100 and sell it a couple years later for $105, well, you're going to get taxed on that $5 gain, but you might be resistant. You might say, no, IRS, you can't do that. See, there's no gain there because there was 5% inflation over that period of time. So you're saying to me, it's a wash. But the IRS says, nope, it doesn't matter. You're going to pay tax on that 5% phantom gain anyway. That's frustrating. And that's exactly why I say that taxation is not adjusted for inflation. Well, for better or worse, the 50 states serve as the laboratories of democracy. We had a big election recently where you saw that truth reinforce itself. Let's talk about property tax, income tax, and sales tax, and let's look at that state by state. Let's look at each one of these three taxes. Now, property taxes, that's an obligation that you pay that generally supports schools, police, and fire protection. And no matter where you live, if you own a property in another state, well, then you owe that state's property tax where your property is located and not where you are domiciled. Now, understand that some states with high property taxes, like New Hampshire and Texas, they rely heavily on those in lieu of other major tax categories. But then there are others, like New Jersey and Illinois, they also impose high property taxes, and they do that alongside other high rates in major tax categories. So I am pulling up and looking at a colorful nationwide property tax map here. And as far as owner-occupied property tax rates go, Hawaii's is the lowest at just 0.3% annual tax as a percentage of the property value. The second lowest property tax rate in the whole nation is in Alabama, and that's a state where rental property numbers make sense. It's just 0.4%. On the high end here, oppositely, three states all have property tax rates that average above 2%. The third highest property tax rates are in New Hampshire, Illinois is second, and the highest property tax rate of all is for properties in what's also America's most densely populated state. Yes, that is the Garden State of New Jersey. And we're just looking at statewide averages here. You got to keep in mind that property tax depends on smaller jurisdictions within the state. Let's look at state income taxes next. Again, I'm pulling up a colorful map here as I'm just going to hit the high points for you, right? I love maps, being that geography degree holder that I am. So income taxes, being that stuff that gets knocked out of your paycheck, is important when we talk about them at the state level. You need to understand that you pay this on top of your federal income tax rate, and that Fed rate is up to 37%. You currently pay state income tax in 43 of the 50 states. Those seven states that don't have any state income tax at all are Florida, Texas, Alaska, Washington, Nevada, Wyoming, and South Dakota. They are the seven state income tax-free states. And then there are two more states, Tennessee and New Hampshire, that are nearly state income tax-free. That's where those two states only tax interest and dividend income. Where the high earners pay the highest rates are currently in New Jersey at 10.75%. They have the third highest state income tax rate. You heard me mention them a few minutes ago. Yep, you also pay high property tax there too. We're talking about income tax here. The second highest rate goes to Hawaii at 11%. And who takes the crown? No surprise, you might already know. The highest income tax rate in America. Yes, this is what you would pay indeed on top of a federal rate of 37% is in California at 13.3%. So now, with federal plus state, over half of your hard-earned dollar goes to income tax alone before you even start to pay the other taxes. And actually, that rate is poised to go up. But I mean, already at 13.3% for state income tax in California, I mean, that right there, that is 1/8 to 1/7 of your earned dollar just for the income tax portion of your entire tax burden and just for the state segment of the entire income tax portion. I mean, geez. Now, you do have to earn more than $1 million just to hit that highest bracket in California, okay? But, and hey, California has a lot of beauty. If you're paying that tax, just be darn sure to enjoy that beach and enjoy the Santa Monica Pier, and Yosemite, and Sequoia, and Redwood. Finally, let's talk about sales tax. Pulling up another colorful map here. Love these maps from the Tax Foundation. 45 states and the District of Columbia collect sales tax. Okay, understand that first. Now, I grew up in upstate Pennsylvania. We were pretty close to the New York state border. I paid 6% sales tax as a Pennsylvania resident. But the good shopping, it just happened to be across the border in New York State, Olean, New York, to be specific. And they had an 8% state sales tax there in New York State. That was actually some small topic of discussion among my family and friends growing up, the 6% sales tax you pay in Pennsylvania versus 8% in New York State. So yes, I was paying 8% sales tax on those Star Wars action figures from defunct Hills Department Store and KB Toys. And I'll tell you, it really cut into the number of stormtroopers that I had flanking Darth Vader there, I guess. But in any case, there are local sales taxes too. So when you combine state and local, And I'm just doing some rounding here. The fifth highest sales taxes are in Alabama at 9.2%. Fourth highest is Washington State, also around 9.2%. The third highest is Louisiana. The second highest sales taxes in the nation are in Arkansas. Both Arkansas and Louisiana are around 9.5%. And the highest sales taxes in the nation, and again, this is the highest average combined state and local, are in, well, the ignominious distinction goes to the volunteer state of, yep, Tennessee. So you'll notice that a lot of southern states have high sales taxes, and quite a few of them are these really good real estate investor states. Well, you can kind of win because what you do is you own property in these investor advantage states and you pay the more reasonable property taxes there. But then your tenant in Tennessee, Arkansas, Alabama, they're the ones that have to pay the high local sales tax and not you. So that's a quick state-by-state look at property, income, and sales taxes. Now, understand that when you pay any of those, they are due annually or more frequent than annually. And then understand this, taxes on assets like real estate investments and stocks too, those taxes are not owed on the gain until they're sold. So that helps people like you investing in real estate. That even helps people like Jeff Bezos, the Amazon founder and the richest person in the world. It helps him grow his wealth rapidly while avoiding a huge tax bill. So you can be strategic about when you sell. So whether it's real estate or stocks, when you stockpile assets without selling, wealthier investors really can minimize their tax burden. And I think that's a point that's lost on a lot of people. And it's really just another disparity between the haves and the have-nots. Before we get back to taxes and bring in Tom Wheelwright here, I've got to share something with you. Gosh, and I guess this goes back to how the scarcity mentality is abundant and the abundance mentality is scarce. Well, with the pandemic being part of the lives of the world, 7.8 billion people by now, we're getting an increasingly better idea of how it's affecting people's mindset and their routine. Well, a recent Harris poll exposed some of this. They found that American remote workers are enjoying a more flexible routine now that they don't have to report to the office. The top three things that employed Americans said they'd miss about working remotely if they had to return to an office were, the third biggest one was being at home with their family. The second biggest thing that Americans value is extra time in the mornings. Well, that's great, right? I mean, what could be more valuable than those two then? Being with your family and having extra time? Oh, geez. The number one response in this recent Harris poll is saving money by spending less on gas and lunches each week, 41%. Oh, geez, are you kidding me? Saving chump change by getting a cheaper lunch at home and spending less on car gasoline? That trumps being with your family and having extra time? My gosh, it just shows you how screwed up people are with their personal finances. This is like Scarce Skip or something. What has he been doing in the pandemic? He's just happy that now that all of his meetings are over Zoom, he can save money because he doesn't have to wear nice pants anymore. Sheesh, be frugal, yes, but be frugal with your time more than frugal with your money. Lost time is irreplaceable. In a world of abundance where you're allotted a finite slice of time called your lifetime, yes, it pays to seek value, but it usually doesn't pay to be cheap. And by the way, I'm not cheap and I'm not for sale. Our guest returns for the second portion of the show. He was here with us 7 weeks ago to compare presidential tax plans. Today, we're talking about more evergreen, permanent, long-term tax principles that you really need to understand for all time, no matter who the president is, and how you can apply them to permanently reduce your taxes for the rest of your life. That's with Tom Wheelwright coming up soon. Hey, these tax maps that I was looking at a few minutes ago and describing to you, they're from the Tax Foundation. They're really colorful, well laid out. I wish that you could see them. There's a national income tax map, property tax map, and a sales tax map. especially if you're a United States resident. You really ought to see these. I will send these maps directly to you shortly, and I'll give you a little color commentary when I send you the maps as well through our Don't Quit Your Daydream letter, this email letter that I write myself. It wires your mind for wealth. It helps you make money in your sleep. It updates you on important real estate investing trends. It is full of value, devoid of hype. And the letter is just real content that makes an actual difference in your life. Rather than living below your means, learn to expand your means. That's how I will send you these cool tax maps as well shortly. And it's completely free. Sign up now at getricheducation.com/letter. Tom Wheelwright and I, straight ahead. Most renter property investors choose either positive cash flow or home price appreciation, but one real estate market can provide both. Jacksonville, Florida, with 9% lower home prices than the national median, 1% higher gross rents, and Jacksonville has appreciated 34% more than other comparable cash flow markets since 1991. Get positive cash flow today and appreciation for tomorrow. To invest for cash flow and growth in Jacksonville, go to cashflowandgrowth.com. The people that our listeners can't stop talking about are Ridge Lending Group and MLS 42056. They provided you with more loans than anyone. It's where I got my last few loans, and they finance single-family income property up to fourplexes. They're the number one lender for both beginners and veterans. Start your pre-qualification, chat with President Chaley Ridge personally, and you'll end up with your custom plan for expanding your cash flowing portfolio. Start at RidgeLendingGroup.com.
Hi, this is Russell Gray, co-host of the Real Estate Guys radio show, and you're listening to Get Rich Education with Keith Weinhold. Don't quit your daydream.
I'd like to welcome a very familiar guest back onto the show. He's the founder of Wealthability and really an expert in helping you permanently reduce your taxes. He is Robert Kiyosaki's Rich Dad Tax Advisor as well. I'd like to give a big GRE welcome back to Tom Wheelwright.
Hey, thanks, Keith. It's good to be here.
There are some basic things that even some very well-educated people in other areas of life don't understand about their income and how it's taxed. And then I want to talk to you about property taxes somewhat. But first of all, I think a lot of people don't understand the fact that tax brackets are marginal. Tell us about that.
What that means is that you'd hear somebody say they turned down a raise because it put them into a higher bracket.
Right.
That's like the dumbest thing ever, because only the raise is in the higher bracket, not the rest of your income. What happens is that everybody has tax brackets. Warren Buffett has tax brackets. You start with a 0% tax bracket, then you go to a 10%, then a 12%, all the way on up to the top tax bracket. But what it means is that the last dollar of income you earn is taxed at your highest possible rate. It also means that the first dollar of deduction you get comes off your highest taxable rate. So understanding that we have marginal tax brackets, we talk about this a lot when we talk about planning with families. One of the things that people don't understand always is that your children have an asset that you probably aren't using. And it's called tax brackets, because your children have their own tax brackets as well. So they have a 10% bracket and a 12% bracket and a $12,000 standard deduction. If you take from your top marginal bracket, let's say it's 35%, and it ends up being taxed to your children at their 10% bracket, that's a 25% swing. So that's a pretty easy tax planning once you understand that, yeah, it's not all of your income that goes into that higher bracket. It's only the increase in your income, but it's also the first dollar of deduction comes off that highest bracket.
That's interesting about the children, but yet I still run into people that, and I'll just give an example here for convenience, not like these numbers are really the proper brackets right now, but if someone makes $100,000 and they pay 25%
as a tax rate on that 100K of income. Yeah, some people think, oh, I don't want to make more than 100K because then I'd pay 35% on all of my income. No, no, that's not true. In this example, which I'm just making convenient, you would only pay a 35% income tax rate on each dollar over that 100K if that were indeed the threshold. So a marginal tax rate, that's the rate which tax is incurred on an additional dollar of income. And in the United States, the federal marginal tax rate for an individual that increases as income rises. It's been that way for a long time. He said something really interesting. The first dollar of a deduction that you get when you earn a tax deduction, that comes off of your highest taxable rate. I think a lot of people misunderstand what a tax deduction means. That's different from a tax credit. I have run into instances, Tom, where I have been out on one of my projects where they're, for example, replacing a roof on one of my buildings, and say the roof is going to cost me $12,000. I remember mentioning to that contractor, well, you know what? I am just going to be able to write that whole thing off on my taxes. And I could tell that that contractor got the idea in his mind that this whole thing, this $12,000 was free. It was going to be paid for by the government, so he could just run up whatever expenses he wanted. And I definitely did not want him thinking that, because I'm not getting a tax credit of $12,000. I'm only getting $12,000 of income, more or less, that's deductible. So tell us more.
Let's start with the credit. So credits are like magic.
Yeah.
Because a dollar of credit is equal to a dollar. For example, if you put solar, there's a 28% solar credit this year. So 28%, if you put $100,000 of solar, you'd get $28,000 back against your taxes. So it's actually a dollar for dollar. A deduction, though, the way it works is we are taxed on our net income, and net means net of deductions. So go back to your $100,000 example. If I have a $10,000 deduction off that $100,000, now I'm being taxed on $90,000, not $100,000. If I'm at 25% bracket, then that $10,000 is worth $2,500 to me. What you always want to look at is a deduction is not as good as a credit, but it's better than no deduction at all.
Sure. Said another way, a $10,000 credit actually increases your income, or the money in your pocket, if you will, by $10,000. However, a $10,000 deduction, that only increases your income or the money in your pocket after you multiply it by your highest marginal income tax rate. If it's 25%, then yes, $2,500 would be the effect that you actually feel. And when you say, I'm going to write the whole thing off with a $10,000 expense, that's what that really means. That means you're getting a deduction on that, but not a $10,000 increase in your net worth.
That is correct. The government is sharing the expense. They're not paying for the expense.
Oh, that's a great way to say it. The difference between a tax deduction and a tax credit there. Tom, most of our listeners are real estate investors. Oftentimes, we invest outside of the home state that we're in. And it's interesting, nationally, homeowners pay about 1.1% of the home's value annually in property taxes. So therefore, for every 100K of property that you own, that means on average that you pay $1,100 per year in property taxes. And when you own a property out of state, you need to pay the property taxes that are enacted where that property is actually domiciled, not in your home state. But Tom, talk to us about some of the differences between states and property taxes, because they have such great differences from state to state and some of the dynamics there and some of the changes that we might see. But first of all, just tell us in general about the property tax landscape state by state across the United States.
So they do vary largely from state by state, right? Some states rely a lot heavier on property taxes than others. Property taxes typically are used specifically for school, fire, police. There are some states that have significant property taxes that go into the general budget, but some states limit it pretty much to fire, police, education, et cetera. So, but they also vary within a state. So this is, you bring this up and I want to make this point. What a homeowner pays and what a landlord pays is not necessarily the same dollar amount. So they're not always the same rate. So sometimes a landlord will pay a higher rate than a homeowner because they say, well, look, if it's your primary residence, we're going to tax it at X percent. If it's a secondary resident or if it's a rental property, we're going to tax it at Y percent. And then commercial property almost always is a higher rate than residential property. If you're thinking about, okay, do I invest in commercial versus residential? One of the things you have to consider is, what's my net going to be on the commercial because of property taxes? I have a commercial property and the property taxes are really high on that commercial property, much higher as a percentage than they are on my home.
And it certainly varies. The northeastern United States and the far west coast, they're known for having high property tax rates. My municipality, since you mentioned, it also varies within one state. In Anchorage, is about 1.25% on what I pay as an owner-occupant in our home. And again, that's as expressed as a percentage of the home's value annually in property taxes. But yeah, it's quite differential. I think Texas is the most glaring example of a state that has high property taxes. Sometimes you'll pay 3% in some Texas jurisdictions, but yet no state income tax.
That's correct. And then California actually has low property taxes, right? Because of Prop 13. They're looking at raising that for commercial properties, but Prop 13 kept property taxes down, even though values went up. It's not just that, okay, well, boy, it's on the coast, so therefore it's more. Not necessarily. Really, what you have to look at is, how does the government raise its money? Okay, not just how much does it raise, but how does it raise its money? We always think of a three-legged stool in state government. We look at income tax, property tax, and sales tax. Those are the three different types of taxes, and every state differs on what percentage goes to each. Like you say, there are states like Texas, Nevada, Wyoming that don't have income taxes, and yet they might have high property taxes, or they might have high sales taxes, because one way or another, you have to fund the government. Looking at the property tax rate, and by the way, we think about income tax reduction all the time. A lot of people don't think about property tax reduction. That is absolutely a real thing, and you need an expert in that, just like you need an expert in income tax. You should always have your property taxes analyzed by a property tax expert, because you can go to the county, which is the one who typically assesses the property taxes. You can go to the county and you can argue that your property taxes, that your valuation should actually be lower than what they have it recorded as.
I want to ask you more about that in a moment, but let's drop back to California's Prop 13, because that does keep an interesting ceiling on property taxes in California. In fact, I think it's such a strong tax incentive that it makes people keep their homes and want to stay in their homes and not move in California. So tell us more about Prop 13 and why that matters in California.
Yeah. So Prop 13 basically says that your tax valuation is tied to what it was when you bought it. So what you paid for the house. So if you bought the house 30 years ago, of course, you know, it might have only been worth $50,000 and now it's maybe worth $800,000. Your taxes are tied to that original purchase price, or probably the price at which the value it was when Prop 13 happened. You've got a much lower property tax if you hold it. That's why you see a lot of people, for example, they have their homes and then what they'll do is they'll keep them and they'll rent out the rooms. I mean, you see a lot of that in California where you have room rentals, and the millennials especially do that a lot. My son is in a room rental like that in California, because it does limit the liquidity of the real estate market. And so it actually helps to keep prices down in California as well, because people don't want to sell.
Kind of puts up walls. And yeah, people want to continue to keep that home because the property tax benefit gets greater as time goes on. Tell us about something actionable then. You mentioned how to reduce your property taxes. In a lot of jurisdictions, you can contest an assessment. Tell us more.
Let me give you an example. So I did this with a house that I bought once. I built a house and it had, if I remember right, 2,300 square feet upstairs and 1,000 square feet in the basement. When I got the assessment, it had it as a 3,300 square foot house. I'm going, wait a minute, basements in Arizona, at least at the time, are not worth nearly as much as a single level home. So my neighbor next door had a two level home that went up, and I went into the property tax, the county assessor's office, and had some help. And we argued that, look, my home should actually be valued less because that 1,000 square feet underground is not nearly as valuable as if it were above ground. Turned out there's a law at the time, there's a rule in Arizona, in Maricopa County, that you're to be considered a second story, it had to be more than 50% of the larger story. Had I thought about that, I could have easily made that 1,200 square feet, right? 200 square feet more basement would have been great. And it would have actually reduced the value of the house from an assessment standpoint. This is the kind of thing you can be looking at is if you have a good property tax consultant, and they will typically charge you, by the way, based on success. So they won't charge you a flat fee or anything. They typically charge based on success. So if they reduce your taxes by $10,000, they'll charge like $3,000 or $4,000, right? They'll charge a percentage of that reduction. Well, it's free money to you. So why wouldn't you do that? Commercial property owners, anybody who owns multiple properties should basically have a property tax consultant on their speed dial because property taxes are such a big deal and it's so easy to contest them.
So to review, tax brackets are marginal. A tax deduction is less powerful than a tax credit, and you can reduce your property taxes often in innovative ways that you're not thinking about, and I'm not thinking about either. And Tom's really an expert in helping people do that. Tom, what else should people know about permanently reducing their property taxes? Any other thoughts there?
I would also consider that you mentioned it, where your property is located impacts your property taxes. So for example, I have a property in Utah and it's right on the county line and one county has higher property taxes than the other county. So if you're looking at properties and you're one of your parts of your analysis should be property taxes because you may go, look, it doesn't matter which side of the county I'm on from an income standpoint, from a rental standpoint. It's the same market.
Right.
So look at the one that has the lower property tax first because that's going to impact your bottom line. So property taxes, we don't think about them a lot. So I appreciate you bringing this up, Keith. It's actually, I think, a very big issue for landlords and something that we can plan. We can put it into our projections. We can look at what is the state doing? What's the county doing? What's the local school district like? All of those things, we tend to think about them from a what's the standard of living in there, but we don't always think about them from a how do they get taxed. For example, in Arizona, if you have a lot of commercial property in a school district, your taxes as a homeowner will probably be lower because they're going to tax the commercial property more. If you don't have any commercial property in your school district, then you probably have higher property taxes. These are all variables and it's permanent, right? Because once you get into a low property tax area, you're never going to have high property taxes.
These are some great points. And when people think about reducing property taxes, they think about, oh, every time I have to go at it and butt heads with the assessor's office. But here, you're being attentive to that early on, and therefore you are permanently reducing your property tax obligation. That's a great way to incorporate this into your long-term strategy. Well, Tom, you've been helping real estate investors and business owners permanently reduce their taxes for a long time. If someone wants to learn more about how you can help with that, what's the best way for them to do that?
Just come join us at wealthability.com. We have a lot of free resources. You're welcome to book a call with us. We're just happy to talk to you and see if there's a way we can help or if there's a way one of our members of our Wealthability Network can help.
Tom, we're right. It has been time well spent. As always, I learn something every time I have you here on the show. Thanks so much for being here on Get Rich Education.
Thanks, Keith.
You know, I don't hear it so much anymore, but sometimes you hear an older person talk about school taxes. Yeah, they say school taxes. That's because historically, the income for your local public schools are so dependent upon property taxes that some people just call property taxes school taxes. Yeah, property tax, there for school, fire, and police. Well, some really good fundamentals from Tom to keep in mind there, like the last dollar of income you earn is taxed at your highest possible rate, and the first dollar of a deduction that you get comes off your highest taxable rate. And then for some actionable items, get your children involved with your tax planning because they have a lower tax bracket than you as an adult, and understand that property taxes are relatively easy to contest. And I've had Tom's network do my personal taxes and my business taxes for maybe 10 years now. They've helped me permanently reduce my taxes just like they can yours. If you'd like to get an introduction to Tom's team, and they will treat you well if they know that you learned about them through me, get started at getricheducation.com/tax. They do my wealth strategy, tax strategy, and the actual tax preparation too. They understand what real estate investors and business owners need, and they make sure that I don't miss out on optimizing all those benefits and deductions for mortgage interest, tax depreciation, property tax related deductions, a cost segregation, which accelerates my deductions. They make sure that I get infinite capital gains tax deferrals. They apply bonus depreciation and a lot more. Taxes are the biggest single expense that you are ever going to have in your life. And the quickest way to increase your net income without reducing your lifestyle is to decrease your tax burden. Get started at getricheducation.com/tax. Happy Thanksgiving. Until next week, I'm your host, Keith Weinhold. Don't quit your daydream.
Nothing on this show should be considered specific, personal, or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate tax, legal, real estate, financial, or business professional for individualized advice. Opinions of guests are their own. Information is not guaranteed. All investment strategies have the potential for profit or loss. The host is operating on behalf of Get Rich Education, LLC, exclusively.
The preceding program was brought to you by your home for wealth building, getricheducation.com.